Jesus would be very comfortable if he were physically ministering today, because he would want to outreach, and he would do it in the ways of the time. And while we are physically small gathering today, we have such a large extended gathering between all of the technology. So I welcome all of you here today, those family members who are here physically, those who are watching us via the media. And today, as we come together, our readings and our prayers remind us of the journey. And you know, you go back. Furman, they are dropping you everywhere, just so you know that. Well, you know, where the grandchildren? Your grandchildren have a very special window into the life of grandparents. Tell me something about them. Oh, who's the smartest? Is it Bryson? We'll start with Bryson. All right, something about grandma.
Definitely, whenever it was like a birthday or something, we'd always have something to do with them. I remember one we went in Boston, went to the aquarium, and it was like an amazing day. And then we got back, we went to Toys R Us, we got toys. And I definitely think I got home and my mom was like surprised that like that was the day that I had.
It's about family.
I think she always went out of her way to make sure that I felt really happy and really beautiful and knew that I was loved. She always had a look in her eye that gave me a really great sense of just love overall. Mm-hmm. And she definitely made me feel really good as a really young kid and how I grew up.
Oh, similar to what you were saying, I think just the birthdays was always fun. They would kind of like kind of make it a day, but she basically can't go out throughout the day. It would like really make us feel like really loved, and it would just always be fun, whatever we would do. And it wasn't necessarily like going to the store or getting something, it was just being with them throughout the day and just enjoying. Being able just to kind of like laugh and joke and be weird and have fun. Obviously, having that at the time, but it was always fun to do.
Something about Grim.
Once she let us paint piles of baking soda in the kitchen, and I remember, and I think it was either her or my mother made a comment about, these are like, look at all this stuff that we could do that your mother would never let you do. So, I don't know, things like that. It was always fun. We always did a ton of fun things.
Yeah, she was always there for us to make things fun, make things enjoyable. I don't know. I had something to say and now I just lost it. So.
She still gives the fans a few bucks every once in a while.
Oh.
That's a joke. And you know, looking back, if I asked the grandchildren, the oldest president you remember, who's that going to be? Don't say George Washington. No, during your lifetime. And Clinton, maybe? Bush? You didn't go back to the
office?
What? Well, you know, Grandma goes back 1931. Coolidge, Taft, Hardy, Roosevelt, Truman, Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, Ford, Carter, Reagan, Bush number one, Clinton, Bush number two, Obama, and all the way up the line. All the people you studied in history, Ford, Edison, Bell, Marconi, the Wright brothers, were all part of Grandma's mom's lived experience. And, you know, we talk about the COVID epidemic, the pandemic, but, you know, Grandma survived her family the great Spanish flu pandemic of 1919, with 6 million people died worldwide. The Depression, she was a Depression child, the wars in 1931 here in Boston at the Peter Bent Hospital, which is now Peter Bent Brigham. They were using this wonder drug for surgery called ether. And when she was a younger child in the late 40s and early 50s, parents were afraid to send their kids out of the house because of the polio epidemic. And no one knew what caused it. And there were no vaccines at that time. Kids were ending up on lungs, often big breathing. So, you know, it's been quite a leap of faith that Mom, Grandma made in their life. And literally, she saw us go from the earth to the moon in her lifetime. And I'm just going to guess, one bathroom in the house growing up.
Absolutely.
You know, you watch Home and Garden TV today, every bedroom has that bathroom. Mm-hmm. I was watching the other night, I'm catching up on television, but the couple was checking off the boxes. The last box, honey, we can't buy the house because there aren't two sinks in the master bathroom. It's amazing Mom and Dad were able to raise your kids under such terrible circumstances. So today, you know, as we come in sadness, but I think more importantly, we come to celebrate the gift of a wonderful life. Because in many ways, Mom, Grandma, great grandchildren?
No.
They're all great grandchildren. she left a legacy, an imprint. And, you know, it's an interesting thing. We don't start our life saying, this is the legacy that I will leave. But a legacy unfolds over time. And you are that imprint, that opus that Mom and Dad began. And how long will it be?
That would have been 64 years this coming July.
And how did they meet?
Through friends. A friend of my dad had a sister who was a friend of my mother's, and that's how they met.
That's the equivalent of Match.com.
Yeah,
okay.
Yes.
That's great. Well, you know, all of those events transpired, and because wedding season is on a hold right now. My brides are very inconsolable. But, you know, the last wedding that I had, you know, you think back to the wedding day, and, you know, Mom and Dad, some 65 plus years, and as I was saying to the congregation a few weeks back, I said, you know, see this couple here? Stars in their eyes. They do not have a clue.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's just as one of us have a clue because we lock ourselves in our rooms. But Mom and Dad began that leap of faith, really not knowing, you know, how things would transpire, all of those things, and move forward. And that's really the gift we celebrate today. Our readings and our prayers remind us of that journey. And is Uncle George watching?
I believe so.
George, please extend all my prayers. I still remember back in the 90s when we took that organ apart pipe by pipe at St. Patrick's Church. So we begin today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, be with you all.
Amen.
Compassionate and loving God, yours is the beauty of childhood, and yours is the fullness of years. Comfort us in our sorrow, strengthen us with hope, and breathe peace in your troubled hearts. Assure us that the love we had for grace was not in vain. Indeed, make it a part of the store of goodness you are even now pouring out upon her in your eternal kingdom. Guide us through this time of sadness with the light of your love and the strength of your compassion. Give all of us the strength and courage to face each new day. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our reading this afternoon is a reading from the book of Sirach. A Sirach we would call a high school principal or headmaster in today's world. And his writings were a way of sharing a lifetime of wisdom with his students. You can almost envision a teacher talking to a student today. And he talks about death and dying. Now I praise those godly men and women, our ancestors, each in their own time. These were godly people, whose virtues have not been forgotten. Their wealth remains in their families, their heritage with their descendants. Through God's covenant with them, their family endures their posterity for their sake. And for all time, their progeny will endure, their glory will never be blotted out. Their bodies are peacefully laid away, but their name lives on and on. At gatherings, their wisdom is retold, and the assembly proclaims their praise. The word of the Lord. Well, I know first and foremost, they extend all of the prayers and sympathy and love. There's so much of the community who could not be here today, to those family members who are here, to those who are watching us virtually. And as we come together today, when someone we love and care about dies, I don't think it matters the age, I don't think it matters the circumstance, it brings out different emotions within us. And emotions are very mixed and varied in depth. We live in such a high-tech world today. Most of my ministry, I just really been here for a week, but most of my ministry is in the city of Boston. I spend years at Boston Medical Center, in the 15th year of hospice. You know, we think that there's something wrong, we check ourselves into the hospital, they fix us, so we come up with a clinical care personnel. Bob's death reminds us of this about that simple. Despite all the technology, all the things we have in our world today, we still don't have the power of life and death. We get angry. We live in a world we want control over everything. I think that's one of the more chilling aspects of the pandemic that we have today is we have no control over it. And we live in a world we want control over all parts of our life. Sometimes we feel relief. We believe that a person's journey is at an end and we find real peace. And so often in hospice, the first question I get asked is, you know, when will my loved one die? And it's the only question I can answer. People die and they die. I initiated that services for our English resident at 5 months old, and I hold this stuff on being free. I can get to figure it out. But each of us are here for whatever period of time on loan. Because this part of our life is just a very small part. And now grandma and mom has come on to the next and more permanent stage of the life. So I think first and foremost we bring out all of the emotion. The second thing that happens is that we remember. And Uncle George was there, her siblings. You know, I remember the first time I went to a wake. It was in the living room of our house. It was my grandma. People traditionally, you have to wake in the room. You start in the living room, go to the dining room. By the end of the night, everyone would be in the kitchen, the dog would be under the stove. That was the longest part of the house. And it was just considered a normal part of human life. If you did that today, you'd call DSS. The kids are going to cry. But here today, we talk and we remember. And we come in and make pictures. Something about mom. You should check out your boyfriend when you brought him home. Or?
No, I used my sister for that.
Well, obviously, you guys, you passed the test.
No, Mom, she loved her family. It was, she loved going to the theater. She was my theater buddy. She was, you know, my cousin in Florida said something to me yesterday about how my mother always sent cards to them. And that's what she did. She always remembered everybody and always loved getting together with everybody. And she worked hard. She always compromised so we could have the best and we would have what we needed. And the same with Dad. They always made compromises for us. You know, we never wanted for anything. You know?
I think you hit it on the head. She had the right for what you needed. Not always what you wanted.
Right. But what
we
needed. Right. It was two different things. I remember the old, oh, I'll split it in half with you.
Something about mom. Which was the most troublesome of the kids growing up?
Oh my God, I'm in California.
No. See,
Michael,
you're not able to protect yourself. They are throwing you right under the bus today.
What did you say?
Yeah.
I mean, we were all good kids, really, just like their grandkids, all good kids, you know.
There's something about mom.
Yeah, she, as Claudia said, she was always working hard, but always on her feet. When dinner was over, we would all go and do our things, and she would be in the kitchen and cleaning up, and wouldn't sit down generally. And I'd say many moms would say the same thing. They are up and moving, doing things, and once
other than that was selfless in doing things for us and supporting us in every way. She didn't get involved in our activities as much as Dad did, but she was always there to support all of us to do those things that we could or wanted to try to do. There were certainly limitations, but she did whatever she could.
I'm sure there was very little that went on that she didn't know about.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, so true. Oh, my God. Even now, her hearing is perfect. I mean, right?
Sometimes you pretend not to hear, but you hear everything that goes on. Was to be reckoned with, I'm sure. But you know, the memories, those things don't die when the person dies. That's part of the family history, the family legacy. And God willing, your grandchildren, at some point, will be able to take a ritual of great grandmother. And, you know, you won't be able to go to the toy store again without all those memories kind of clicking back. The birthdays, just all of those things. And finding somebody you love and care about dies. Mom's death, grandma's death reminds us of all that you do. You don't know the time, you don't know the place, and you don't know the circumstance. And you know, I think she's giving us a good Easter gift. Because today we have a chance to look at the things that have gone on in our lives. I remember when I was in the city, I had a grand school in high school. And he said, because writers made fun of talks to me, he said, I thought I could get away with that writing. But I gave the ninth grade an assignment one year, what is a saint? We came up with the best definition of a saint that I've come across. You won't find it in the theology book or philosophy book. It is that a saint is a person who does the best they can with what they've got. And you know, that's not a fair definition. Because today we pay tribute to a saint, not a perfect person. If you look at Grace's life, Mom's life, Grandma's life, each step along the way, she did the best she could with what she had. And looking back now, you look at the resources, she did a remarkable job to keep the things together. You know, the word homemaker is not politically correct today. But if you take that word homemaker, someone who makes a home. And that's quite an accomplishment in someone's life. You're able to make a home for so many people. So here today, as we bring our emotions, we bring our memories, we bring our sense of journey. And today, we look at our own lives. What are all the things that have transpired in your life or my life that brought us here today? Where are we right now? And where will we be 2 weeks, 2 months, 20 years from now? At the time of your death or my death, what will our life have said to the world? And will people be able to say with us, we did the best we could with what we could. And when we have so many people saying all the nice things that you said about grandma and mom today, when it's our time to continue the journey through. You've heard the word of God. You've had a chance to reflect upon that word. Now we join in prayer for Grace. In response to our prayers this afternoon, this Lord, we are prayer. We pray for Grace, whose baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that she may now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray for the Lord. We pray for our sister Grace, with the body of Christ, the Eucharist, that she may be raised up on the last day. We pray for the Lord. We pray for our deceased relatives and friends. We pray for all those people who are good and kind to Grace in her life, that they may have the word of their goodness. We pray for the Lord. We pray for the family and friends of our sister Grace, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. We pray for the Lord. We pray for all of us who have gathered here this afternoon, both here and in our virtual world of faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord. Amen. Oh, good for you. Michelle? In school?
No, I work for family.
Oh, okay. Hayden, where'd you get?
Hayden's in California.
Ariana's in California. Ariana, Greeny's in California. Okay, Hayden. Work school?
I work for a hospital.
Oh, good for you. How come you're out today?
Because I work generally normal hours, so.
Isabel?
I am currently in college from UNT.
Oh, good for you. What'd you major?
Environmental.
You know, it's interesting that since the pandemic, the atmosphere in Miami has been 30% cleaner.
Everyone's traveling.
Yeah, even in Venice, the water is now turning blue again and all those things. And Bryson?
Yeah, I'm a sophomore at third MBA in UMass.
Oh, what are you studying?
I'm a biologist.
Well, good for you.
Can I just say Hayden, beautiful in California? He's a high schooler, just so you know.
Oh, all right. Hayden, and who else is in California? We've got
Ariana and Greeny, but they're working. Greeny's an architect and Ariana works for Stanford University. So just to, because they're watching.
Oh, no, I don't want to miss anybody. Before our final prayer and blessing, I'm not going to speak long about the cemetery. For those that are watching today, the ritual of the cemetery is very, very simple. As we welcome Grace to the grave, good place of rest, we bless the grave. Reminded that the grave is a very sacred and holy place. The grave is a repository of the most sacred relic that we have, the body of the deceased Christian. And the grave is a spot where we put flowers and notes and candles. Just all of those things remind us of the presence of that person in our life. Is Mama a good cook?
Yeah, I thought so.
Grandma a good cook?
Some
the jury seems to be out on that.
Some things, yes.
There's a difference of opinion. I thought she was a great cook.
I thought she was great.
She taught them. My Irish husband had these Italian meatballs.
Oh. She wants you to marry an Irish. I remember the first uncle that brought an Irish girl home. My grandmother chased him all over the farm. You thought the world was going to end.
Unfortunately, that was true.
Now, she turned out to be the nicest of the aunts.
Yeah.
But it was a battle.
Yeah.
So, God bless you. I mean, obviously, you must have been the one. I don't know if it was you or Claudia. I was the first minority pastor at St. Margaret's in Winchester. They've all been Irish since 1880.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
So they welcomed me to the parish and said, Father, we're very happy that you're here, but we never thought we would live to see this day. And they sent me to Ireland for 2 weeks to get acculturated.
Oh, did they?
And I had a wonderful time with that two more times after that. And when I made my report back to the parish, I said, I want you to know I learned two things in Ireland. First, you cannot get home even Catholic. It has an American dish. And you drink cold wine.
And your point is?
Within the Christian tradition, Catholic tradition, mothers are held in very high esteem, beginning with Mary, mother of Jesus. And I just asked the question about if mother's a good cook, because if you search the Gospels, nowhere do you find Jesus eating at home. He always was on the road or somewhere out eating. I always wondered if Mary just wasn't a good cook. But there's a story about mothers that I think speaks about. It's called Mother's Journey. The young mother set her foot on the path of life. Here's the way long she is. The guide said yes, no way is hard. You'll be old before you reach the end of it. But the end is better than the beginning. But the young mother was happy. She would not believe that anything would be better than these years. So she played with her children. Picked flowers with them along the way and bathed with them in the streams. The sun shone on them. Life was good, and the young mother cried out, nothing will be lovelier than this. Night came and then the storm. The path was dark. The children shook with fear and cold. The mother then drew them close and covered them with her mantle. The children said, oh mother, we are not afraid, for you are near to us, and no harm can come. The mother said, this is better than the brightness of day. For I have taught my children courage. Then the morning came and there was a hill ahead. The children climbed and grew weary. But at all times she said to her children, a little patience, and be a little. So the children climbed and climbed. When they reached the top, they said, we couldn't have done it without you, honey. When the mother lay down that night, she looked up at the stars and said, this is a better day than the last. For my children have learned fortitude in the face of hardness. Yesterday gave them courage. Today I'm giving them strength. The next day night came. Strange clouds covered the earth. Clouds of war and hate and evil. The children groped and stumbled. The mother said, look up. Lift your eyes to the light. The children looked and saw above the clouds an everlasting glory. It guided them beyond the darkness. That night the mother said, this is the best day of all, for I have shown my children God. The days went on and the weeks and the months and the years. The mother grew old. She was little and bent. Her children were tall and strong and walked with courage. When the way was rough, they lifted her, for she was light as a feather. Then at last they came to a hill. Beyond the hill they could see a shining road and golden gates going on. The mother said, I have reached the end of my journey. And now I know that the end is better than the beginning. For my children can walk alone, and their children after them. The children said, you will always walk with us, mother, even when you climb through the gates. The children stood and watched her as she went on alone. The gates closed behind her, and the children said, we cannot see her, but she has stood with us. A mother like ours is more than a memory. In peace, let's not take our sister Grace to a place of us.
So this concludes everything here in our home. We just want to say a final goodbye. I got to use the bathroom. I'll be in front of you.
Did you have anything in the room today? What if you want to have something?
Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Love
you all.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Hope to see you soon. Good luck with things, everyone.
I didn't bring the phone, the battery.
Unplug this?
Yeah.